Do you like knights? Do you like motorcycles? Do you like endless debates on art versus commerce? Well, we have a movie for you today on The Bomb Squad. Today's movie is our second movie in the fantasy, and the best thing about it is it's neither fantasy. It's not
barely a movie.
It's not, yeah, it's not fantasy. It's barely a movie, but it is a month long. That's how long it is. So today's movie is Knightriders, the 1981 George A. Romero film. So this movie stars Ed Harris in his first role. It also stars Tom Savini, our favorite sex machine. And I do like, if you didn't listen to the Dust Till Dawn commentary or haven't seen Dust Till Dawn, you just assume that I'm very attracted to Tom Savini, which
he's
I am.
A charismatic man.
Yeah, so Knightriders, it's about it's like a Renaissance troupe, and that's it. That's like the movie.
Well, okay, the weird thing is, it's not even necessarily, like, it's not about a Renaissance troupe in the sense that, like, yeah, they put on shows for people, but Ed Harris is, like, the king of the troupe, and right. He's, like, disgusted with the idea that anyone would ever profit from or enjoy this. He's against making money. He's against drugs. He's against sleeping with random women. And it's like, why do you like this life?
The movie is 2.5 hours. It's 2.5 hours long. It is so long. Like, it's one of those 1970s meandering movies, even though it was in 1981. And, like, you could just tell, like, okay, from the poster, I thought this movie was about, like, a gang or maybe post-apocalyptic gang.
There's no fantastical element to this whatsoever.
No, instead what it is about, it's about a troupe of people who they want to live a Renaissance life, kind of. Maybe it's just Ed Harris. And so they go town to town performing these, like, skits.
But there's so many scenes of them just breaking down how expensive this lifestyle is to maintain.
Yeah.
And, like, all their arguments are good ones. They're like, hey, Billy. His name's Billy. He's, like, Sir Billy. Hey, Billy. We're losing, like, multiple motorcycles every tournament. And it's very costly to either get new ones or repair them. And he just, like, gets angry at people for pointing this out. So, like, that's never... He never has a good argument for, like, what they're going to do to make money. He's just like, no, it's about honor. It's like, yeah, but we still need to pay for gas and, like, motorcycles and...
Like, Ed Harris is the king, but he never says what he gets out of it. Like, because, he says stuff about, like, honor and, like, this is the way of life. But he never says exactly what he...
Yeah, there is...
What's
there
the
is
goal?
Because his queen, whose name I didn't write down or remember...
Yeah,
is like, hey, you know, this is about our people.
I'm not trying to be a hero. I'm fighting the dragon.
Following. That's all you get. Like, you don't know, other than that he just thinks it's really cool to pretend to be a knight and, like, fake joust. Like, you don't know anything else about why he's so passionate about this.
Yeah, he says that line about fighting the dragon, and I was like a real dragon or, like, drugs? Or what the hell are you talking about?
Yeah, which is funny because, again, like, going back to Easy Rider, if this movie had been, like, hella stylized and, like, really went deep in, like, the aesthetic, I'm like, this could have almost worked in that same way. But it's all played straight. Like, there's very little style to it. There's a few scenes where you're like, oh, that's kind of cool. But there, very much of it is just like, yeah, here's a static shot of them riding motorcycles and then jousting. It is agonizing how long the jousting lasts and how interesting it is to watch.
There's, like, a scene later where they're just driving to, like, because they, like, have a falling out and then they decide to come back. And they're just driving through the mountains or whatever, and you just watch them driving for, I think it's like 5 minutes. And it's like, I don't even like this if these were cool modern motorcycles and you had, like, cranes and drones and stuff. I definitely don't like this when you clearly are just in the back of a pickup truck filming them at. Alan is, like, the second in command, and then he picks up this girl named Julie, and she's like, he's, like, explaining kind of their way of life. Because he's like, oh, yeah, we joust and you pick a car to see who your opponent is. And then you see who's the better one. And then we just keep going until there's only one person left. And then she, like, puts, like her necklace around his jousting thing. I don't know what it's called. Lance. It's a lance. And she's like, this is for luck. And he's like, did a guy give this to you? And she's like, no, my dad did. And he's like, oh, are you sure? And she's like, okay, yeah, a guy gave it to me. And he's like, it's bad luck to give a knight this. And then he like jousts and he wins. And then he's like, now it's good because...
There, now you have something to hang on my lance. She's got plenty to hang on your lance.
Why is this in this movie? Why did you spend so much time talking about...
You can tell that George Romero spent a lot of time thinking up the logistics of how their codes of honor work and was like, no, you're going to see all of it. You're seeing my entire thought process.
And like, there's a scene early on where like a crooked cop comes to the Renaissance Fair and they've already got a permit. How do I know they got a permit? Because they talk about it for like 5 fucking minutes. And they already have a permit from the sheriff, but the cop wants like a bribe. And he's like, okay, well, just pay me my bribe. And Tom Savini's like, yeah, pay him a bribe. And Ed Harris is like, we're not going to pay you a bribe because of honor. And I was like, just pay him the fucking bribe, dude. Like, and like, I don't understand. Yeah. Like, it's not even like counterculture thing. It's like, oh no, they want to stay inside our society, but just kind of be knights there. And then later, the cop comes back and he like finds a reason to arrest a random pothead who works with the troupe. And Ed Harris is like, oh, well, if you're going to arrest him, you have to arrest me. And the cop's like, okay. And so they arrest them both. And then it cuts from them, from Ed Harris saying to bring me in, to the Chief Wiggum cop just beating the shit out of the pothead dude.
Yeah, it's like a heart. Like, it's one of those things. The editing in this movie is all over the place. But this is one of those where it just kind of cuts from dialogue to, it's like a smash cut to this dude getting beaten. But not in like a shocking way, in like a, oh, he didn't know a better way to cut to this. And it's like playing soft jazz while the cop is beating him. And it's so like, what the fuck is it? Like,
you better stay. See what you can do.
I got some ideas. No! You wanted a belt on me! On me! You wanted a witness? Well, how can witnesses? They don't count for much.
So then they get bailed out, I guess. Like, it's so easy how they get out of this. And Ed Harris, like, threatens the dude. But then they get back, and Tom Savini's like, okay, guys, we need to start making money off of this. And then Ed Harris goes, no, my friend just got beat for something we believe in. And I rewounded this scene, despite this movie being 10 hours long. Because at no point does the pothead go along with this. He gets arrested for having pot. He doesn't, at no point does he want to be beat or say anything about agreeing to do it because of the honor system that Ed Harris lives on.
Not only does he not go along with it, but there's a scene between Ed Harris rejoining the group where they're just camping out at night and the guy's like beat up and he's like, yeah, I don't really believe in honor. I believe in survival because of how often the cops have like unjustly beat me. So it's like, I feel like if you hold to ideals to the point of being suicidal, that's just going to get you killed. And so even in the scene before this scene, that guy is like, no, Ed Harris, you're wrong. This is not... I disagree with the reason I've been beaten.
And like Ed Harris's character, like he doesn't seem well-liked within the group. Like you never see him like joking around with anyone or even really talking to anyone that's not his wife. Yeah. And even his queen... near the end is like, oh yeah, I don't like you that much.
In the very beginning, where a kid is just like, oh, you're really, this jousting thing is really
cool.
Oh yeah,
that scene.
Can you sign my magazine? Can you autograph this magazine? He's like, I just don't do that, kid. And like screams at the kid and walks away. And even his queen is like, yeah, why didn't you just sign his magazine? Who gives a shit? You know, and he's like, you don't understand.
And then I'm going to spoil something. At the very end, Ed Harris is driving around after he leaves the troop and he just gives, he finds that kid at his elementary school and he gives him his crown and his sword. And for like the first 10 minutes, I was like, or for like the first, like when that scene was introduced, I was like, did he have a son that I didn't know about? And then I was like, oh, it's
well,
the kid.
Too, and he also, okay, in the last 10 minutes, he meets that kid again and he meets the cop again. But that happened so early on in the movie and is never brought up again. Like, it's like, oh yeah, that was 2 hours ago. I don't remember these characters.
The only scene that was good was he beats the shit out of the cop, and then everyone starts clapping, despite the fact that they don't know why this random crazy guy just walked into a fast food place and beat the shit out of this cop. But you know what? I was on board with that. Good job. I would have clapped for you too, Ed Harris.
I did enjoy that. Yeah, where it's just literally, because I kind of almost feel like that wouldn't have happened until like 2020. If you just saw a guy walk in and start beating on a cop, yeah. Most people would be like, oh my God. But now they'd be like, yeah.
Yeah, so they cheered for him, and I cheered for him, too.
I enjoyed that scene. But so there's a few good moments in this movie.
Yeah. No, that's just the only one.
You don't feel connected to any of it. Even the characters you're kind of following, you're just kind of like, all right, what's happening now? Like eventually in the middle, after he gets really mad at everyone because they, like, money too much.
Well, yeah,
they all leave.
Because the guy from Gennaro from Jurassic Park comes out and he's like, hey, I like what you guys are doing. We want to put you on TV and we'll pay you. And everyone's like, of course. Why else would we do this? I mean, that's the best way. And Ed Harris is like, no. And they're like, why? And he's like, no more questions. and so the whole middle part of the movie is Tom Savini kind of like breaking apart and being like, okay, well, we're going to do this because money exists and we need it in this world.
I mean, Tom Savini too, and they kind of frame it as like, oh, he's like kind of the trick, like the roguish one who's not totally, because he even says at the beginning, oh, I was never in it for the night stuff. I just like motorcycles, man. And then, yeah. So it's kind of like, oh, his arc throughout the movie is learning to love the night stuff. But, I think Gennaro from Jurassic Park actually has some pretty good comedic chops in this. I don't know. I think that guy just does a good job of playing like a sleazy like agent. Like whenever Ed Harris bursts in and gets mad at everyone, he sees that they're eating pizza, then he gets mad at the pizza. And so he throws the pizza on Gennaro, and Gennaro goes like, hey, I didn't order this. Like, it's such a stupid joke, but you're like, oh, someone's trying to be funny in this movie, you know? Like, it's like, oh, he's actually quipping and not just,
yeah, the
talking
two
about money.
Because it's Gennaro, and then it's his like wife/partner, and both of them have some pretty funny moments. Like, there's a scene where the wife is like having sex with Tom Savini, and he's like, oh, so this is your job? And she's like, no. I mean, we're partners, and so Gennaro pays for most of this. And he's like, is he going to be mad? And she's like, no, we just kind of do this every now and then. And it's like, okay, can we follow these two characters? Because their life of finding random troops to put on TV and being weird swingers who have pool sex parties is way more interesting than anything we've seen up until this point.
Yeah, there's such a disparity, too, because you're kind of like, oh, Tom Savini loves this. Like, now he's, like, partying and he's getting money. And then the thing that makes him go back at the end is he kind of sees his guys trash a hotel room a little too much. Like, he's like, I don't know about this. And he, like, leaves it. It's like, what? Why was that, the breaking point, you know? Like, and it's just, it feels so like, oh, why would this be the thing that gets you to...
And that's the weirdest thing. Like, next week we're going to watch Excalibur, and we're going to see, or if you look at history, or if you know anything about knights, they weren't full of honor, I'll tell you that much. they like to do things a little bit rough. That's the weirdest thing to me, is that, like, it's like Ed Harris has like an 8-year-old's understanding of what a knight is. And then they have like another tournament to decide who the king is. If Ed Harris wins, we can't do this anymore because they all get back together. And if Ed Harris loses, then Tom Savini can do the TV show. Ed Harris wins. And then he's like, okay, well, anyway, I'm going to make Tom Savini the king because I've learned that it's not just about me, it's about all of us. And so he makes Tom Savini the king, and then Tom Savini goes up to Gennaro, and he's like, take your contracts and litigate them. And then Ed Harris is like, yeah, I learned that great lesson. Okay, now I'm going to leave. And I'm like, what? And he starts bleeding from his arm.
From
yeah. And then yeah. He has a dream, And then he gets hit by a truck. And then they all go to his funeral and they're like, man, I really wish we had fucking signed those contracts because we're all poor as shit. And then the movie ends. I kind of feel like this movie is about a weird deranged man who's a threat to himself and everyone around him, who eventually dies, but very slowly. Yeah.
Where there's like, there's no jokes, there's no jokiness. It's like wanting you to take at face value that this is the most deathly serious, like, motorcycle troupe you've ever seen.
And he's clearly trying to say something about the idea of art versus commerce. And when do you like bend the knee, so to speak? But I don't know what he's trying. Like, I don't know what conclusion he's reached, unless the conclusion is just be poor until you kill yourself, right. Which seems ill-advised. But yeah, I think that's the thing, is it's like, and it happens a lot with George Romero movies where it's like, I know what your thesis is, but I don't know what you've concluded at the end.
Yeah, that's the only interesting thing, is like the night stuff with like shield guys riding in a row on motorcycles. They're like, this is kind of cool. And then, I mean, you know it's not going to last because it's about to be a really boring, like, jousting scene. But the aesthetic isn't bad. There's just not really, they don't do anything with it.
So. Yeah, it's not good. It's not bueno. But yeah, so medieval month is off to an okay start. We've got one and one for good and bad. But yeah, so next week we're going to watch Excalibur. But yeah, if I had to rate this movie, I would give it a bad night and not a Renaissance fair. Excalibur. See you guys then, Josh. Get us out of here.
I do the... Dar, 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 dar. Yeah. Like that's like the, okay. The trumpets ending it. Yeah.
Sure. Bye-bye, guys.